Britain is an island, surrounded by a cold and unforgiving sea. For centuries, it protected us from attack. But to prosper and thrive, we would need to do more than just hide behind her saltwater shield. Britain needed brave men, willing to venture out into the unknown, and she needed good boats to take them there. I've spent my life at sea. Now I'm going to take passage on six boats that together tell the story of modern Britain. Built for exploration, war, fishing, industry, and our very survival, these are the boats that built Britain and changed the way we live forever. And this time I'm going to be aboard an LCVP landing craft, the vessel that spearheaded the D-Day invasion and played a vital part in the final victory of Britain and the Allies in the Second World War.
This is an LCVP, a landing craft vehicle and personnel, built to do a specific job to land troops on a hostile beach in the teeth of enemy fire. Lord knows she ain't pretty, and those sharp corners make a seaman's heart bleed, but she was the right boat at the right time. In our hour of greatest need, this boat saved Britain, and there are not many boats can claim that.
Developed from a Louisiana swamp boat, the LCVP is one of the strangest craft ever to take to the water. 36 feet long and powered by a 250 horsepower Detroit diesel, she's capable of carrying a platoon of men and all their kit ashore at 12 knots flat out. By the end of World War II, over 20,000 of these extraordinary little craft had been built, using production methods that revolutionized boat building. Designing a boat like this called for radical thinking. But cometh the hour, cometh the man, and Andrew Higgins, a hard-drinking, straight-talking American shipbuilder, proved that this boat was the answer the Allies had been looking for. But just how did this design come about? And what was it about Higgins that made its creation possible? Because make no mistake, this is an extraordinary boat that goes against almost every rule of design. Doing what no boat really wants to do, leave the water and drive straight up the beach.
Ask any sailor where he does not want to be, and he will tell you, on the beach, where the sea meets the land, that's where the real danger is. But at the end of World War II, that is precisely where he had to be, getting thousands and thousands of troops ashore, right here, on this very beach.
So, how do you go about designing a boat that can sail for hours across the English Channel, and then deliver a platoon of almost 40 soldiers straight into the teeth of enemy fire? It's a huge challenge, and one the Allies could ill afford to get wrong. Nowadays, we're so used to the idea of amphibious landings that we take it for granted that military craft can motor up a beach and deliver troops at full speed. But between the wars, when military chiefs first considered the problem, they faced a serious hurdle. Traditional boats just couldn't handle the job. They were great at sea, but when the time came to step off and fight your way ashore, the high sides and V-shaped hulls of conventional craft meant that the men ran into all sorts of difficulties.
Back in the early days of World War II, we took a serious drubbing. We managed to get the British Expeditionary Force off the beaches at Dunkirk with a ragtag navy, of little boats begged, borrowed and stolen from goodness knows where. But if we were going to win the war, a few years later, we had to get back onto those French beaches, and this time it was a different story.
Now the Germans would be waiting. Dug in, their machine guns zeroed, their mines laid, just looking for the chance to shoot up anything that came their way. It was a daunting prospect, but one that needed addressing and fast if launching the huge D-Day invasion was to be successful. The problem facing shipbuilders goes to the very heart of boat design. Most ships tended to have deep V-shaped entries, great for keeping you upright in the water and cutting through the waves, but a disaster when running aground. What was needed was a whole new type of boat.
I've come here to meet an old shipmate, Ian McGilvery. Ian is every inch a sailor man, but the difference between him and me is that he is also an expert boat builder.
All right, mate.
And to help illustrate the problem, Ian's going to build a couple of very basic models that will show us the two extremes of hull design.
It's a good bow there, eh, Tom?
Beautiful.
Cut the water like a drink.
The first is a flat-bottom boat. A box, really. And the second, its more usual V-shaped opposite number. Each offers advantages and disadvantages compared with the other.
Okay.
Rough and but ready, to understand but fully what these are, we'll have to float these boats in the water, starting with the traditional V-shaped hull.
Do you want to give it a go?
Yeah, okay, here we go. Oh, look at that. Useless.
Well, that's no good then, is it? It's no good for a landing craft or anything else. Put some ballast in it, a few old nuts.
But once we add a bit of ballast, as you'd get in a boat of this type, things improve dramatically. The boat settles in the water. Suddenly, she's remarkably stable. And with all that boat in the water, she'll also handle well. Her draft will stop her being blown off course, and the V-shaped hull will chop readily through the waves.
If it's a landing craft, it's got everything you want, except for the fact that when you put it on the beach, falls over.
No good.
No good at all, is it? Let's have a look at this one. We'll start with it on land, which is what it's for.
Spot on.
Four. Can't beat it, can you?
No, not at all.
If we put it on the water, it's pretty good on the water as well, on the face of things. What happens if we put some weight on the side? It's absolutely amazingly stable. You put a lot of weight on and it stays stable, and it's got to go a long way, a long, long way before it tips over. In fact, even then, it comes right way up. So it's not got a stability problem.
Just as an idea, load carrying ability, that's a lot of nuts there. A lot of weight. Look at that.
That's huge, isn't it? Of course, it's doing that because it's got so much displacement, isn't it?
So far, so good. But you really wouldn't want to take this design to sea.
The problem it has got, I think, is that if there's a sea running, it's going to pound something awful. And
up over a wave, the bottom of it is just going to bang. It would be an awful thing to steer because there's no keel in there. There's nothing to stop it going sideways on the breeze.
I mean, that's the shape a landing craft has to be, because starting from the land, there's no choice. But it's not going to work like that. It's got to be more sophisticated than that.
The flat-bottom boat has a lot going for it, but Ian and I suspect there are going to be some serious disadvantages out on the water. To find out what these may be, we're going to have to test our tiny wooden model on a human scale. However, I wasn't quite expecting this. I've sailed on hundreds of boats over the years, but this is the first time I've ever set sail in a skip.
Right, we middle for diddle.
But Ian thinks she'll float, so here goes.
Be very interesting to see what happens now. I've got my life jacket on, so I'm ready for anything. A lot of ballast in the bow here, and we're starting to float. And how are we floating? She's feeling my weight, but she's pretty good fore and aft, actually. Just about right, and she's blowing about like a crisp packet, as predicted.
Whoa!
What do you think?
I was hoping it was one going to start so we didn't have to go, but never mind.
Feels more or less okay so far. But how's she going to handle under power?
Right, well, should we give it some... Whoa!
We've got to be a bit careful we don't duck the stone under.
We've got this 4.5 trim issue, but if I go here and you put some power on, will she squat and work? There she goes. That's it. So we're off. The good news is the skip floats. The bad news is it handles like a dog. Back in World War II, those guys really had their work cut out.
The first problem is direction. There's nothing gripping the water. We're just about getting away with it here on the river, but throw in a few waves and our square metal box will be all over the place. But there's another problem, even worse. It's called cavitation. Every time we try to open up the engine, we lose power because the flat bottom lifts and channels air, not water, down onto the propeller. On a V-shaped boat, the propellers would be deep down in the water and you wouldn't get this problem. But you can't have them there on a landing craft. They'll snag on the beach. It's a catch-22, and it's one the boat designers of World War II are going to have to solve fast to have any chance of coming up with a successful landing craft.
Somehow, those guys had to find a way of feeding water onto that propeller without putting the propeller so low down that it was going to graunch itself onto the beach as they were driving in.
It's clear to me now that what they needed was to combine the best of the stability and load-carrying box design with the seakeeping qualities of the V-shaped hull.